इधर अपन गणपति बाप्पा मोरिया मुनि आता है।
रीड द ट्रेलर।
हाय गाइस,
हाय।
टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट अ मैन कॉल्ड बोस। वी बोथ आर क्रेजी अबाउट बुक्स एंड वी फाइंड एनीथिंग दैट्स नॉट बुक रिलेटेड हाईली सस्पिशियस टू इन्वेस्ट आवर टाइम इन। सो वी वर लाइक ओके चलो लेट्स टॉक अबाउट बुक्स एंड वी वर टॉकिंग वंस इन one of our like legendary morning
yeah,
books,
box.
Where we use about everything about life books. And then we were like, okay, let's do this in person, let's meet and talk and discuss about books.
I think for us, we've been wanting to do this since 8+ months, maybe more. You know, that start. Maybe. Let's start a book club. Let's start a book club. Let's do the book review thing.
Yeah.
Especially because I wanted to get back to reading.
Yeah, and the idea is to bond with like-minded people who are also crazy about books. And if they aren't, then like let them join the club, because J.K. Rowling has famously said that there's no non-reader. There are only people who haven't found the right book. All right, drum rolls. How are we going to start? What are we starting with today? What's the video about?
So today, the first book that we both read and we are going to review and talk about is A Man Called Oak. You want to show them the book?
Yes.
A Man Called Oak. I can't tell you how many times my mind read the word Ove as love.
But I think he's a Swedish author, so I think yeah. Ove might be a like common name there. Like it, okay, this is a question I've been dying to ask you. How was it?
The initial few chapters, I must say, I found him very irritating. But then you grow to understand him. I don't know, I'm not sure if I can say you grow to like him, but to understand where he comes from and his behavior and his character traits, so you grow fond of him by the end of the book, that's for sure.
Just like to give people who are watching this background of the book, it's about this grumpy old man called Ove, who is living in a small neighborhood in I think Sweden, and the whole book is around his life, past, present, future. And the fact that I thought that Riddhi will like it when we were discussing about which books to review first, I thought it would be Ove, because I know that both of us are people who love good writing over plot, plot, plot. And this doesn't have a plot as such. And I know that because Riddhi reads like Murakami, and in Murakami there is no plot. The plot is very, very thin. But there's a lot of good writing, so I was like, okay, this can work. So it's about this guy, how he's going about his life. He's like a grumpy old man, he's a widower. Okay, firstly, spoiler alert. So if you have...
this every video of ours has to have a spoiler alert, because we cannot talk about the book absolutely without not giving anything away.
If you haven't read the book, go read and then watch, but stop watching right now, because it might spoil the fun. Okay, so it's about this old man, and I have seen Oves all around, you know, though they are like, and I have felt like
live in your homes.
Yeah, and I know people who like go about their lives like they're angry at everything and everyone, which is basically Ove, and how they have this tender soft side to them, or how they became those grumpy old men. And then there's this neighbor who enters his life, who's like a daughter figure, not labeling relationships here, but she is somewhat like a daughter to him. And then how they grow a rapport, and how she really reintroduces life in his survival, to call it, because he's not enjoying living much. And it's a very, very funny book. It's very funny. Did you find it funny, Riddhi?
I think the author just makes sure that you laugh or you smile at the end of every single chapter, and sometimes twice. Like every chapter ends with you smiling. Wow, because he's so witty the way he's made the chapters, you know. And I mean, for him to write it like that, because every chapter has a flashback, has a present, has a flashback. Yeah. There's that constant jugalbandi that's going on, but still, it's very funny.
And he hasn't tried to globalize it, so it's very peculiar to the neighborhood. So the car references. So Saab. I don't think Saab is a car that everyone knows.
I think maybe a few of us. First chapter itself, I had to go online and Google.
And Google.
What is a sub? Exactly.
Yeah. Same. So there are a lot of things which are very peculiar to their culture, which is also why I feel that everyone should read something which is so different and so uncomplicated. You know, sometimes we feel that great writing is the writing which has a lot of complexities and complications, and then they get resolved in the end, and then that's good writing. But I think that this is it's very funny, and it's not funny in a way that, you know, it's not gusaud in the book. It's just because life is funny, and if you look at it with that lens,
I didn't know whether I was laughing or laughing at him for his for his faculties. I know the author has used the word faculties, and I'm like, wow, who says faculties anymore?
Yeah, or even, you know, this thing, I have seen this in a lot of Marathi writing also. So Pula Deshpande, who's a Marathi writer, has also spoken about how old people love litigation and how they, like, you know, they want to
paper.
Sue people. I have seen that my grandparents also being very particular about documents, signatures, going to the bank documents.
Oh my God.
I don't think they would have ever adapted to net banking ever. I feel that essence of, you know, having a grandpa and this whole graph, like, you start with disliking him, as you said, and in the end you
reach a point in your head where you feel that, yeah, it would be nice to have someone like Ove in your life.
Just there.
And obviously because he gives something really nice to the kid in the end.
But it's heartbreaking. It's heartbreaking and funny in parts. I feel that there were times when I was reading with a lump in my throat, because it was very emotional. And especially because it doesn't let you remain emotional for long. So there will be an emotional para, and immediately in the next para there will be some observational humor which snaps you out of your emotion. Which were your favorite characters?
I think I did like the lanky one and the pregnant woman. I think more than like you said, you know, Parvane was for him like a daughter. I think he saw a lot of his own wife in her, the behavior, the nature, the bubbliness. You fall in love with his wife a little bit, you know, when you read about her.
Yeah.
I think my favorite character was Parvane and his wife, definitely.
And his wife, no? Yeah. Same. So I think that there is, you love his wife so much also because I'm sure she was a lovely lady, but also because you look at her from his lens. So everywhere there is like, what impact did she have on him? And then you love her even more. I loved obviously his wife and Parvane, but I also like the character of Roon. That funny.
Matlab, Karan Arjun types tha unka wo, jo bhi tha.
Yeah. And they were so alike, and that's why they had the fights and the friendship that they had. So
the phase where both of them had pregnant wives and they just used to like chill out on the porch. I think that was cute.
I like Roon's character also because it gives a dimension to Ove. It really shows that side of Ove which was not above bonding and friendship. You know, he can come across like a very stern person, but he was friends with Roon and they did share a good rapport, and that really came through. Yeah, so I like Roon also, and I loved Sonia.
Yeah, she could be a friend.
Totally.
About Ove also, like how he's always living by principles, and most of the time you realize that, you know, like his whole childhood he's thinking about what to do with respect to what his father would have done, and then he meets his wife, and then suddenly everything he does after that is what to do when, you know, she's around. Like, what would she want? Which makes me wonder, why isn't he thinking for himself? For an independent person who's been living on his own since 16 years old, he's always depended on other people to do things. He doesn't let his actual sternness or his anger or his irritability manifest because he has that principle and he has that checklist. He's living by a code set by different people, but he trusts those people in his life so much that he's ready to change his inherent character.
But I also feel, and you're very right in saying this, because after Sonia, it's Parvani. Her daughter.
It's so always someone. He's always trying to do things someone better than him wants him to do.
Yeah, like, better is, I don't know, better as in who's more in charge, maybe. Because he is not authoritative at all. But, you know, though he may come across as someone who's very, like, a bully, but in reality, he isn't. When you said that independent wala thing, I just thought that he was independent, as in he was orphaned at the age of 16, so he didn't have a choice. Mm-hmm. But I also feel that to give your life a structure, you need to have roots, which we call principles.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, and we all have those for ourselves. But uski principles were like a long, long list, because he needed an extra structure, because the structure that family gives us, the structure that society gives us, he didn't have that, because he didn't feel connected to the society and he didn't have a family. Maybe that's why he had like so many principles set out for himself. And regarding the dependence, no, I feel you're right when you say that he was emotionally very dependent to live like a fulfilled life. But he did not change himself fundamentally. So he was,
right.
He brought to the table that he could bring rather than borrowing it from here and there. So even with Sonia, where he is, where it's mentioned that, you know, she read the books and he made the best bookshelves, because bookshelves were something that had a manual and he needed a clear instruction manual. And yeah, he didn't try to read Shakespeare. He didn't try to be like her, but he tried to support her in the way that he could. So yeah, what you're saying makes sense. I'm wondering why he centered his life around these people.
But he ended up bonding with people who were not like him more than people who were like him.
Because people who are like him are so they are just so hard to make a conversation with. How is he ever going to bond with people? And he's so dismissive of people. I get him totally there. Yeah, you know, the disappointment he has when people are stupid. I get it. I really get it. Yeah, maybe people who are unlike him, but I feel like Parvani and Sonia are very unlike in that manner, that his wife is very, very soft and Parvani is very strict with him. So, you know, she is a little bit like, oh, if he glares at her, she'll glare back. Whereas Sonia was someone who had a very... See. Yeah, so maybe that, you know. I also found one more thing interesting, that with that no character is overused. You know, they come and they go. It's a story about Ove. But even Sonia, they haven't indulged in their love story. They don't tell you everything.
Enough to know about her. Enough to know about them. Enough to give a background about why he is the way he is right now. I think that's what the author is trying to do every time he talks about her, because he's trying to build up to that point where Ove just cracks, possibly.
Right. He does, and he does often. Huh? And I think the loveliest part is because you read it from the point of view of Ove, and it's so matter of factly. So should we read something that we like from this? Because I want to read something which brings out Max, it can. I think Riddhi, we are going to have a lot of similar favorite passages. So we just have to find a way of not saying every time, oh, me too, I also. So this is when he and his wife met for a date, where she only had to tell him that, okay, now ask me out for a dinner date, because he wasn't doing anything, because he didn't know, basically. Mm-hmm. It's not like he didn't want to, because he didn't know how to. And then he's anything but a playboy. So they don't meet at the allotted time. They have decided to meet at an allotted time. And Ove reaches there first. and he's waiting for Sonia, and now this is what happens. For more than 15 minutes, he stood waiting for her at the station in his tight-fitting suit and his nail-polished shoes. He was skeptical about people who came late. If you can't depend on someone being on time, you shouldn't trust them with anything more important either. He used to mutter when people came dribbling along with their clocking in cards 3 or 4 minutes late, as if this didn't matter. As if the railway line would just lie there waiting for them in the morning and not have something better to do. So, for each of those 15 minutes that Ove stood waiting at the station in his tightly fitted suit, and then the irritation turned into a certain anxiety. And after that, he decided that Sonia had only been ribbing him when she suggested they should meet. He had never felt so silly in his entire life. Of course, she didn't want to go out with him. How could he have gotten that into his head? His humiliation, when the insight dawned on him, welled up like a stream of lava, and he was tempted to toss the flowers in the nearest bin and march off without turning. Looking back, he couldn't explain why he stayed, maybe because he felt, in spite of it all, that an agreement to meet was an agreement. And maybe there was some other reason, something a little harder to put your finger on. He didn't know it in that moment, of course, but he was destined to spend so many quarter hours of his life waiting for her that his old father would have gone cross-eyed if he'd found out. And when she did finally turn up in a long floral print skirt and a cardigan so red that it made Oak shift his body weight from his right foot to his left, he decided that maybe her inability to be on time was not the most important thing. Okay, my phone fell because I got...
Your phone fell in love.
It did. And so did I, again, with them.
Dude, I'm telling you now, but yeah, I mean, that's the same thing that I have highlighted. Because you just know those moments. Loving someone is like moving into a house, Sonia used to say. At first, you fall in love with all the new things, amazed every morning that all this belongs to you. As if fearing that someone would suddenly come rushing in through the door to explain that a terrible mistake had been made. You weren't actually supposed to live in a wonderful place like this. Then over the years, the walls become weathered, the wood splinters here and there, and you start to love the house, not so much because of all its perfection, but rather for its imperfections. You get to know all the nooks and crannies, how to avoid getting the key caught in the lock when it's cold outside, which of the floorboards flex slightly when one steps on them, or exactly how to open the wardrobe doors without them creaking. These are the secrets that make it your home. So cute.
So beautiful.
There's this one sentence that the author says, which I really like. People said Ove saw the world in black and white, but she was color, all the color he had. I loved that sentence.
Love.
You know, I always think about how we keep talking, you know, the world is not black and white, it's gray. And we forget about all the colors. I think it was probably one of my most favorite sentences of the entire book. She often said that all roads lead to something you were always predestined to do. And for her, perhaps it was something. But for Ove, it was someone.
What should I do with this heart of mine?
And literally, you know, like this is how Frederick ends. Every chapter, you know, he makes you go, oh, or he makes you go,
Which is the most funny incident that you, there was this one that I was reading last night, I was even laughing thinking about it.
I don't know exactly, but I think it could be his conversation with the computer salesman. Found out really
That is very funny. Oh God. Of the part, I'm looking for it now. Where he locks up the journalist in the garage.
I loved that part where the author says the garage door speaks.
Oh God, it was so funny. I made a mention to myself
if I had to write a book, I'm going to do that. I'm going to make things talk now.
now here it goes. Okay. So there's this, Ove has inadvertently saved the life of this man who was going to die on the railway tracks. And a journalist has seen him doing it. So now she wants to interview him. And she's after his life, please, like, you are a hero and we want to save, like, we want to ask you of certain questions for our viewers, type journalist. They're like a paparazzi. And she's after him, and Ove doesn't know what to do with this teacher called journalist. He's very suspicious of her, and she's following him everywhere. And then this happens. Some knocking sounds were coming from inside the garage door. What was that? Said Parvani, staring at it with surprise. Ove suddenly seemed extremely interested in a particular section of asphalt under one of his shoes. The cat looked a bit as if it was about to start whistling and trying to walk away. Another knock came from the inside of the garage door. Hello, said Parvani. Hello, answered the garage door. Parvani's eyes wide. Biding. Christ, have you locked someone in the garage? Ove didn't answer. Parvani shook him as if she's trying to dislodge some coconuts. Ove, yes, yes, but I didn't do it on purpose, for God's sake, he muttered and wriggled out of her grip. Parvani shook her head. Not on purpose? Not on purpose, said Ove, as if this should wrap up the discussion. When he noticed that Parvani was obviously expecting some sort of clarification, he scratched his head and sighed. Her, well, she's one of those journalist people. It wasn't bloody me who locked her in. I was going to lock myself and the cat in there. But then she followed us and, you know, things took their course. Parvani started massaging. I can't. I have to laugh now. Parvani started massaging her temples. I can't deal with this. Naughty, said the three-year-old and shook her finger at Ove. Hello. Hello, said the garage door. There's no one here, Ove hissed back. But I can hear you, said the garage door. Ove sighed and looked despondently at Parvani as if he was about to exclaim, you hear that? Even garage doors are talking to me these days. Parvani waved him aside, walked up to the door, leaned her face up close and knocked tentatively. The door knocked back as if expected to communicate by Morse code from now on. Parvani cleared her throat. Why do you want to talk to Ove? She said, relying on conventional alphabet. He's a hero. What? Okay, sorry. So my name is Lena. I work at local newspaper and I want to interview. Parvani looks at Ove in shock. What does she mean, a hero? She's just prattling on. Ove protested. He saved a man's life. He'd fallen on the track. He held the garage door. Are you sure you've got the right, Ove? Said Parvani. Ove looked insulted. So I was just like, this? And when the three-year-old says naughty.
Naughty.
Oh, God, I love it.
I like the part where he, you know, even though he's so old and stern, he still takes that kid in his house. Or, you know, he lets the cat stay. Or they form the, and every time a cat comes, I don't think after reading Murakami, I can ever look at cats the same way again. Because every time a cat comes in the picture, the book is going to take a different tangent. So I was kind of thinking ke yaar pata nahi abhi kya karne wala hai, kyunki I feel like what if Sonia goes inside the cat and, you know, my brain starts going on that Murakami tangent. And I asked myself, but then I was like, no Riddhi, this is too much. You have to let this author talk and not the other author talking.
Yeah. There was this one sentence when he's orphaned and it's written that maybe there was something about the whole situation that Ove lost his family before he had his new set of family. It just made me feel, and I felt that in the end, finally, he got a family of his to replace the family that he had lost.
Yes.
And you know, with all, even in our life with our parents, I feel that even by the time they lose their parents, they have their own family to feel the sense of, you know, kinship. But with Ove, that didn't happen, and then things ensued, and then he became bitter, as of you might call him. But yeah, that was my most lasting memory, when he finally finds a family, and it's hard work.
Yeah.
The cover says, and it doesn't lie, that it's the most heartwarming book you'll ever read. and we agree.
So do you think you're going to read this author's other book? It's a non-fiction called called Things My Son Needs to Know About Life.
Oh,
like this might
now
this,
I might.
This actually makes me feel like he's writing a prequel because it's Ove's father writing about things his son needs to know about in life because Ove didn't get a chance to figure it out.
Oh my god.
I don't know.
I don't know why my mind made
that connection, but it did.
Now I'm sold. Now I might. When you said non-fiction, you lost me there. But when you said that it might be a prequel to what
it
his
father... It might be a handbook
there.
For all the men who might not end up becoming Ove's.
Oh, I also have to mention the way they have spoken about love. You know, the word unconditional is not used once. I think the word compatibility might be used like once or twice here and there. But what comes to the most is how love, marriage, companionship, like they are not discussed when it's natural. It just flows.
Oh, yeah.
You flow from love to marriage to companionship, friendship, and without making any fuss about it. There were no expectations.
There's no unnecessary analysis and, you know, statistics in knowing what will happen. It's just, you know, you go with the flow and it happens. And it's random kicks of be nice to each other.
Yeah, I love that about it. The way it shows, like, love comes through. Yeah, you were asking me something. Huh? You were asking me if I'll read the author. Yes. When you said that it's lessons to his son, now I will. Mm-hmm. I want to. I really, really want to now.
This is our page, so follow us on Instagram. Check the link in our bio.
Yeah.
Dude,
I am not as talented as you, so I'm using a cover that's not...
This is an invitation for anyone and everyone who wants to get back to their hobby of reading, who wants to discuss books with us. Let us know in the comments.
Know in the comments.
Which books you want us to read, which books you want us to discuss about, which books you want to read with us. And we can have more people in the podcast.
Constructive feedback, criticism, everything is welcome.
Bye.
And bye. See you. I am feeling butterflies. I don't think I felt such butterflies when I was in love also. Edit that, obviously.